The Freebird and Doubly's Y-Wing came out of hyperspace at the coordinates deep inside Thull's Shroud. It was supposed to be where the displaced command center had been resettled, but no one was here.
Are we sure this isn't a trap of some kind?
Roach asked.
Patience, little termite,
Doubly said.
They'll be here.
Sure to Doubly's word, a large Nebula-class frigate appeared out of the clouds almost right on top of them. A blockade runner appeared at its flank as well. They were surprised by how close the capital ships had been without being seen. Welcome, Captain Vance, came the familiar voice of Captain Fabry as he swooped down toward them in his Y-Wing.
Is this home now?
Doubly asked. For the moment, Fabry said. You'll want to dock with the Centurion to get briefed by General Cloudman. The two ships did. The person they had rescued was sent immediately to sickbay, where she could be treated for all the damage that had been done to her. Meanwhile, the team headed toward the front, where Doubly and Yalto showed everyone where the briefing room was. Inside, General Cloudman was finishing a holographic meeting with the leaders of the revolutionaries, Briley and Tornak. Seeing her still stung Doubly, but he knew it was for the best. Cloudman told the pair that the team who had connected them to the rebellion had just arrived. They said hello, and the team entered and said hello back. Roach hurried to the table and looked it over, fascinated by its elaborate setup.
Can we fit one of these on our ship?
He asked. The two in the hologram laughed, and Tornak said they should probably get back to their preparations. Cloudman agreed, and they said their goodbyes, Briley looking directly to Doubly and holding up her hand to say goodbye to him. He stared back, trying to retain a blank expression until her image disappeared. Cloudman then told them that the revolutionaries would be attacking House Casito, eating away their infrastructure while their own forces would be freeing up House Kellerman, and gathering resources for a major attack.
Shouldn't you be looking for another rebel base?
Yalto asked. Cloudman shook his head. That time has passed, he said. The Alliance has provided us with this capital ship and are sending more resources for an important mission. Now, what I'm about to tell you is top secret and must be kept undercover at all costs. Everyone looked at Roach, especially Cloudman.
What? I can keep a secret.
Roach protested. Cloudman then, hesitantly, began to explain as he placed up a map of their region of the galaxy. Alliance Command is making a bold attack on a neighboring sector. It's so big, they hope to take down the Empire once and for all with it. The best thing we can do to help is to cause enough chaos in the sector that the Empire sends reinforcements, then to tie up those reinforcements so they don't get back in time for the final showdown. The group watched in stunned silence. They couldn't believe that this could be the end of the Empire, or the end of the rebellion. Cloudman concluded by telling them that they had several attacks planned and were preparing to implement them. They now needed every operative they could get to either fill the ranks or accomplish some missions. Yalto informed him that they had a mission they believed to be of great importance. He described the tower they had seen and all the discarded bodies.
Dark experiments of deceit,
Doubly explained.
Stealing the essence of those sensitive to the Force and giving them to others.
We believe they're creating an unbeatable army of Force-sensitive people that could be used to foil your plans. I believe it's worth pursuing.
Where would you be going? Cloudman asked. Yalto explained that the one person they had saved from the tower had said she had heard some of the servitors speak about a city where their headquarters were. They had expected all of the prisoners to die, so they didn't know she would be able to tell anyone. The city was called Garjan, but no one on the team had ever heard of it. Maris Cloudman perked up at the name. That's perfect, he exclaimed. Garjan is the capital city of Sayamara. Everyone continued to look at him blankly. Sayamara is where all the houses gather to make decisions for the Twin Sectors. The United Houses building is there in Garjan, and the entire city centers around the diplomatic trade. If this operation you're following is there, it means they're doing something to interfere with the houses. If you can turn the houses against them, that would be the ultimate way to distract the Empire in those sectors. The team agreed, and Cloudman told them the names of the two houses who were most friendly with them. House Kellerman and House Elegin. Then he gave one last piece of advice. We may not be able to speak again after this, the general said. Remember, sow chaos wherever you can. Just get the Empire's eyes on you. They all saluted, then headed out. While they waited to refuel, they wandered the ship a bit. Yalto requisitioned a jetpack to have connected to his armor. Roach refilled his grenades, and found that they had an interesting piece of equipment. A synth skin. Supposedly, one could change the entire appearance of their own face into someone whose DNA they had taken. Roach had trouble believing that, but he was interested in seeing it at work, so he requisitioned it to take along. Once the ships were ready, The Freebird and the Y-Wing detached from the Centurion, then turned and flew away, launching into hyperspace toward Sayamara. Gargan Flight Control called them. Master Dentra told them that they were with House Krizlat and were on their way to the United Houses. The flight controller seemed uninterested and provided landing information. As they flew toward the spaceport, they got a good look at the opulent city. Tall, silver buildings reached for the sky, many with golden statues stretching out of them. None were taller or more ornate than the United Houses building standing boldly in the center of the spiderweb of speeder-filled roads. Over to one side, a little more than a mile away from the UH building and the accompanying lavish offices around it, sticking out like a sore thumb, was a skyscraper whose black exterior seemed to suck in all light around it. The spiky decor resembled that of the Dark Tower on the Rogue World. Surrounding it was a three-story wall, and as the group flew over it, they could see clumps of people training on the grounds between the building and the wall. The team had already discussed what they would do, so when they were on the ground, the entire team went to visit the offices of House Elegin except for Doubly, who remained behind at the spaceport to see if he might be able to locate the smugglers, pirates, and other members of the underworld. It was the type of life he used to lead, and he had a nose for finding his own kind. House Elegin had been approached by the Cenex Rebel base while Vresh and Wynn's teams were investigating the Super Trooper program. In game terms, they had used some of their manpower points to get a diplomat, and they had sent it to House Elegin's capital to pull it to their side. They had focused on this one government the entire time because it surrounded their base, and they had won over their loyalty. This was working in their favor particularly well now because one of their planets sat along the route the Alliance fleet would be using, and it would work to their benefit again now since it provided the team with a local connection. The offices of the diplomats were all in one area of town not far from the United Houses building itself. Finding House Elegin's was not difficult. However, when they inquired for the diplomat, she had not yet arrived. They had landed early in the local time, just before businesses opened up, so they waited. Roach noticed the name of the diplomat along with her picture.
Ilama Wolwill.
You know, we're inventing this game, and we are choosing to use these very hard-to-say things.
Ilama had last arrived and found the team in her lobby. She looked nervously over at Yalto, barely fitting in a chair and nearly causing it to break. Next to him was a kid who smiled broadly at her, and then a serious-looking woman who didn't look like she wanted to be there. But then a man with a much more peaceful demeanor approached her.
Greetings, Miss Woolwill. I believe you know my cousin, Duke Krizlat. We are of House Krizlat, and we've come to speak with you about an important matter.
Ilama froze for a moment, uncertain how to respond. But then she said, "Of course, my office is right back here." Yalto stood up and asked,
"Do we have assurances of privacy? Of absolute privacy?"
"Why, yes," Ilama said as her eyes nodded toward a location where an eavesdropping bug might be. "But you must have worked up an appetite on your long flight. We should go to get some breakfast." Roach stepped toward the diplomat. He had that look on his face that everyone knew by now. Yalto and Ellor both grabbed him and held him back. Dentra approached Ilama.
"That would be lovely. Where shall we go?"
Ilama named a place not far away and how to get there. Yalto turned Roach toward the outer door, and they left. Once outside, Yalto suggested that Roach and Reggie explore the neighborhood. He expected to have to convince Roach to go do something else. But instead, the boy excitedly turned to the droid, who stood at the same height.
All right, I've been waiting this whole time to have an adventure with you, Reggie. Now, it's time to hit the streets. Fist bump, buddy.
The droid extended a metal arm from one of its flaps, and it tapped Roach's fist. Then the boy and his droid disappeared down the street, happy as could be. Ellor, too, separated from the group, informing the others that she was going to go check out the facilities they had come here for, or at least the wall surrounding it. Yalto agreed that it was a good idea, so she walked off toward the skyscraper. Dudley was having a more difficult time than usual figuring out where the smugglers, pirates, and other scum and villainy were hanging out. This city kept up a heavy veneer of respectability, but every town has its shadows, and the brighter the light, the deeper the dark. He at last realized that the people he was looking for were right there in the pilot's lounge. Like most ports in the Twin Sectors, it was the one with the most non-humans, many of whom did not like to stray too far from their methods of escape, but also baggage passed nearby, so most jobs that required tight lips could be garnered here. Dudley had managed to spark up a conversation with a local Trandoshan who helped match pilots with cargo. It was the perfect connection as he knew everything going in and out, and he believed in information for a price. The only problem was it was difficult to understand him.
Most non-humans don't have a lot of business on Sayamara, he said, except to import and export. But there are still a lot of us here for one reason or another.
Dudley asked him who ran the black markets, in case he needed to avoid them or pay his respects.
That'll be Sunset Thado.
Come again?
Dudley asked.
Sunset Thado. You want to stay on the good side because they're a subset of Crimson Dawn.
Are there any houses I should be concerned about, aside from all of their casual racism?
Dudley asked as he scooted some more credits over to his new friend.
I'd stay clear of House McCoon. They got a reckoning coming to them.
A reckoning?
Dudley asked.
Yes. They've been ripping off other houses for a while. And some of them have figured it out. The walls are closing in on them.
Anyone in particular leading the charge?
Strako. Strako's got battle droids held over from the Clone Wars era, and they're pretty militant. McCoon's none too anxious to have them come collect.
The Trandoshan went on to say that just about every house had something on them that other houses wouldn't like. But right now, he had to go. His comm was buzzing, and he knew what that meant.
I've got to go deal with the transfer. House Petrol has been moving slaves and chemicals to Carcavidian. If you decide you want to do a smuggling job, they've got lots of jobs.
What if I want to find you again?
Dudley asked.
Ask for Sid, he said. Sid Salacious.
Dudley. Dudley Vance.
The wall was tall and sleek with a rounded top. Ellor tried to find some weakness, but there was none. Even a grappling hook would slide off. The one exception to this was about every 1,000 feet or so where bulges denoted guard towers. Strangely, there were no guard stations nor guards at the top, just mechanical textures. This was probably where cameras and alarms were hidden. Ironically, this would be the easiest place to connect a grappling hook, but they'd be seen making the attempt. The wall itself was thick. She had seen that from space. And it all looked new, brand new. As in no handprints. Though this city seemed eerily pristine, Ellor didn't want to think about what they did to vandals who smudged their precious city. There was one entry point, a gate along a major road that led directly into the tower. What is it with this guy in towers? She thought. A shiver ran through her. She had expected to feel anxiety, but this was beyond a natural emotion. Something surrounded her. Something was searching for her. Ellor strolled away from the building, then hurried down one of the side streets away from the structure. Dentra and Yalto had already done a thorough check of the diner both inside and out. They saw why Alama liked it. Wanting to attract diplomats who valued private conversations, several of the tables were sectioned off from others. The two men chose one they liked and sat at it. Yalto felt around under the table and swept the ground with his feet to make sure there were no bugs. Alama found them and sat on the opposite side. Yalto began to speak, and Alama pulled the menu up in front of her face. The two men looked at one another confused. I can still hear you, she said. How can I help you? Dinsha quickly caught on, and he put his menu up in front of his face.
We would appreciate your guidance while we are in town.
What are you here for? She asked. Yalto put the menu in front of his face and said,
We'd like to see the house turn against the Empire.
Well, that's convenient timing. We're debating on that very topic today.
Turn against the Empire?
Yalto said a little loudly. Dinsha tapped his arm to remind him to keep his voice down. Ilama cleared her throat, then said, The Empire has declared our sectors to be dangerous, full of rebel agitators. I can't imagine what they mean by that. They want to bring more forces into the Twin Sectors to rid the infestation. Of course, once they are here, they will probably stay, and the houses have a proud history of remaining autonomous. So the debate is over whether or not to allow them to increase their presence here.
And where do you stand?
Dinsha asked. House Elegin believes in its sovereignty. We also know that once a predator begins hunting in your woods, they have no reason to leave.
Do a lot of houses agree with you?
Those who are not naive or have a private deal. I figured this was the reason you had come, so I compiled a list of every house and which side they are leaning.
When does the vote take place?
Dinsha asked. First thing tomorrow morning. Whatever convincing we wish to do needs to happen by the end of today.
What about the Imperial presence? I've noticed that the policing is done by Imperial troops.
It is an Imperial planet. Something the Old Republic convinced our grandparents to do when they were building the United Houses. They convinced them that it was the best place for it because they were neutral. But the buildings are all run by the House Lords.
And the big black building?
Yalto asked. Ilama's menu lowered down to just under her eyes and she looked knowingly at Yalto. Then she covered it again and said, All Imperial.
Do you know what goes on back there?
No, but I might be able to find out.
In the meantime, we would like to help you convince the other houses to keep the Empire out of the Twin Sectors.
Dinsha said.
How can we best help you?
I think you should come with me to the United Houses meeting, she told Dinsha. I can have an extra set of credentials made for you, and you can come into the meetings to assist me. She turned to Yalto and slipped the information about the houses to him under the menus. And you can work from the outside to try to discredit the ones who are leaning toward voting yes tomorrow. Both operatives agreed, and Yalto hid the paper she had given him. Ilama then put down her menu and said, Right, who's having pancakes? Roach and Reggie had wandered pretty far from the spaceport, and they found themselves near a corporate building they had figured out had the regional offices of a bank inside. They watched from a distance, pretending to be just a boy and his robot waiting for a bus. What they were really doing was watching for a target. Roach had told Reggie to keep a lookout for anyone who was near his height going into the corporate building. It was the beginning of their work day, so the employees were filing inside.
Leave the details of the plan up to me, little buddy. I've got them taken care of. Hey, how about after this, I get you a fresh oil injection? All right then, let's find just the right person.
Not much later, they spotted the perfect mark. It was a short woman with long brown hair. Most importantly, she was dressed to impress. Roach zoomed in with his macro binoculars and he saw her name tag. Finance manager. Roach liked the sound of that. Every room of the United Houses was grand, with tall ceilings, wide halls, plush carpet, and curved stairways. Ilama led Dinsha to their entry into the center, where they stepped onto a curved balcony. Other similar balconies ringed the round chamber. All of them pointed toward a circular stage in the center near the bottom. Dramatic lighting crisscrossed onto the platform where a lectern sat before a speaker who was railing against the Empire. She was not speaking of their ill deeds or lack of equal rights, but rather their unwillingness to share power with sovereignties already ruling their star systems. Dinsha whispered to Ilama, asking who that was. She told him that it was Kaisava Passrap of House Hacks. They have a thriving agricultural market, and they want to be left alone. As the representative continued to passionately and expertly warn of the dangers of the Empire, Dinsha looked around the assembly to see how different people were reacting. Each house had their sigil on the front of their balcony. He did not yet know which was which, but he learned quickly, asking Ilama whenever someone's reaction seemed telling. Though helping him learn the politics of the Twin Sectors was distracting, the Elegin diplomat found his insights useful. Yalto, Doubly, and Ellor met back at the Freebird to make plans. Roach and Reggie also came in, but they got bored quickly and went into the next room to play holographic chess. Yalto laid the information Ilama had given him in the middle. It showed the 11 main houses of the twin sectors and a little bit about each one. They would be the only votes that would really matter in the next day's election, so the team needed to figure out how to get them to their way of thinking. Written in parentheses was the direction that house was leaning politically. Then came the name of the lead diplomat. Then a note about them. Then whether they were currently inclined to vote yes or no.
We need to start by giving the houses something to rally behind. I thought something up. I'd call it Make Our Sectors Great Again, or MASGA for short. In short, we convinced the houses that they didn't need the Republic. They don't need the Empire, so let's keep them out.
Dudley moved on, explaining that he met a contact who helps with smuggling on the planet, and he explained what he had learned from him, including the name of the local syndicate, and the fact that House McCoon had been ripping other houses off and they were figuring it out. Ellor added what she had learned about the walls around the Imperial building. It was going to be nearly impossible to get inside, but Dudley wanted to remind everyone that this was their primary goal.
This facility is not here for someone down the road,
he said.
This facility is here for now. My fear is that they'll be using them to take over these houses sooner than later.
I share the same concern, but Ellor's confirming something I was already suspecting. We're going to need help getting in, and it'll probably be in the form of getting these houses to turn against the Empire. So what I want to do is prime these houses so that when the elegant diplomat takes the floor, she only needs tip everyone in the right direction, and they'll fall in line, like a house of cards.
He then told them what time the representatives were supposed to go to lunch, because that would be the perfect time to catch them outside the safety shell of their building. So they needed to decide who they would approach. Consulting the list again, they saw that the only allies they had were Houses Petro, Elegin, Kellerman, and Strako, and House Hax was neutral. Other than that, everyone was supportive of the Empire. However, there were only 4 yes votes so far, so they were starting out ahead. Yalto wanted to first assure the yes votes from those who seemed shaky in their loyalty. Then they would try to get the yes votes to reconsider. So they determined that Dudley would go back to his smuggling contact and try to get more dirt from him. Ellor would go speak with the representatives of House McCoon since they were vulnerable right now financially. Yalto would go speak with their other ally, House Kellerman, to see if there's anything more they could get from them. Yalto then called for Roach to come in and get his assignment. Roach leaned in and said confidently that he already had an assignment.
What do you mean you already have an assignment?
Yalto asked.
We're knocking off a bank,
Roach said. The other 3 team members turned their heads quickly at the kid. He was going to need to explain this one. Ilama took Dentra to the finest restaurant he'd ever been to at the top of one of the skyscrapers. Yet no one was seated at their tables. Everyone was mingling around the snack bars, balconies, on the ballroom floor, at a communal table, and over the glass enclosures to the giant shark tank. It was a gaggle of attachés, envoys, agents, cabinet members, negotiators, mediators, and the occasional diplomat. All the former titles fed to the latter, who made final decisions at the council. But Dentra could tell that the dignitaries took advice from their underlings if enough of them were convinced of something. He was presently being introduced to Kaisava Pazrap, lead diplomat of House Hax. She seemed to indifferently shake his hand, but he took it and kissed it, then told her how brilliant he found her speech.
It was, in fact, some of the most important words I'd wager this body of governments have ever heard.
Kaisava smiled politely, but partly rolled her eyes, and began to change the subject. But Dentra held the initiative and added to what she had been saying. Ilama was at first disturbed, but Master Dentra's adept use of words was invigorating. She studied Kaisava's face and saw it was loosening, becoming curious, open to a new point of view, something Ilama had not seen in her before. It seemed Ilama's new apprentice was a prodigy. He completed his thoughts and asked her questions, though Ilama could tell that they were leading questions. He had her answering the way he wanted her to, whether she knew it or not. And what was more impressive, he had her giving an argument in favor of the rebellion without her knowing. House Hax had been anti-rebellion, anti-alliance, anti-republic, as much as they were anti-empire. They didn't want anyone else interfering. But by the end of their conversation, You would think she was ready to go back home and convince their sultan to join the rebellion. She excused herself to go eat her meal, which had arrived at her table, but she added, "I look forward to seeing you again, Mr." He took her hand and said,
"Dentra."
He kissed it, then said,
"Master Dentra."
Her forehead rumpled, and she looked oddly at Ilama, who told her it was good to speak with her, and the hack's representative went to her table. Ilama scooted up to Dentra and said, "That was cleverly done."
"I have certain talents,"
he said.
"I was born with mystical powers."
"I bet you were," she said slyly. "But be careful. We're being watched by agents of Vandron. Give it a moment, then look over my left shoulder. You'll see a man with a purple tie and a woman in a green gown. They're with Vandron. The man in the white suit pretending not to be with them is Imperial. They've been watching you through your whole disquisition." Dentra waited a moment, then glanced in that direction like he was scanning the room. He saw the people she was speaking about and could tell they were monitoring him, so he looked away. But just as he did, another figure passed between the Vandrons and Imperials, someone familiar. Dentra's face instinctively jolted up to look. Not seeing what he was looking for, he pushed past Ilama and hurried toward his target. But whomever he had seen was gone, and he had blown his cover at pretending not to have seen the house and Imperial agents. Ilama placed her hand on his shoulder and said, "Come, we should eat our lunch before we have to return." Doubly maneuvered through the lesser-traveled parts of the space station again until he found himself in the path of his contact. Sid was moving some goods to a smuggler's ship. He saw Doubly, who only stared at him enough to show he wanted to talk. So Sid finished his business, then went to sit near him.
"I'm looking to move some dirt, if you know what I mean,"
Doubly said.
"Dirt is cheap," Sid said. "Quality mud is costly."
"I can sling hard enough to change someone's mind. Someone big at House Sreethin."
He placed 1,000 credits down. It was most of what he had. Knowing that the end game was near, the group was going for broke.
"Regrettably, I have little on Threefin," Sid said. So Doubly began to pull the credits back. "But I have some rocky mud on the Rabba."
Doubly pulled his hand away from the credits.
"A Rabba would be nice,"
he said. Sid scooped up the credits with his scaly hand and told Doubly to come by here in exactly 1 hour. They would do what was called a flyby handoff. Doubly nodded and strolled off. Ellor checked several restaurants until she found a group of attachés of House McCoon at a place where the customers all scooted up to the grill where the food was made. Ellor made herself up as nice as she could and sat within clear view of some of the guys. Sure to form, one of them moved up to a chair next to her, and she began flirting with him. She played herself off as new to House Seligin, then started asking how he felt about the vote the next day. She began to make fun of the very idea of letting the Empire into their territory. He began to realize that he was being played, and began to leave. That's when Ellor grabbed his arm and reached into the Force to try to use the Jedi mind trick on him. She only felt dark energy around herself, but that didn't matter to her. She began to use it anyway. But as she did, she got a strange feeling. The same sensation she had felt on Zeluria when it felt like hundreds of eyes were coming out of a fog, searching for her. It seemed as though the dark energy was like a bright spotlight being shone on her, so she didn't use it. The man grew angry with a strange woman grabbing him and staring into nothing, so he yanked away and started to move as quickly as he could.
"We know about the scams you've been pulling on other houses,"
Ellor said suddenly. The man stopped, then looked over at her arrogantly. "Yeah, I'm sure you do." Ellor named some specifics that Doubly had learned from Sid, and as she did, the man's smug smile dropped. She approached him, her voice just low enough that no one could hear, but they would be able to if she raised it just a little. She told him that her people know a lot about their double dealings.
"So here's what you're gonna do, big boy. You're gonna go back to your people, and you're gonna ask them if having the Empire Park in their sector is worth every other house turning on them."
Ellor then strode out the front, leaving her tab for the man to pay. Roach waited near the entrance of the building with the corporate bank. He hoped the woman who was close to his size hadn't brought a sack lunch. Others were pouring through the doorway to go to nearby restaurants, and he lingered near an alleyway waiting to catch her face. Reggie was more exposed since it was less conspicuous, and it was reading each face with its enhanced sensors. Reggie whistled when she appeared in the lobby heading toward the door. so Roach headed toward her, squeezing his eyes to get the waterworks going. He was in full helpless child mode, sobbing, breathing heavily, appearing helpless. She asked him if he was okay, and he said that his father was in trouble. There had been an accident around the corner, and he was badly hurt. "I'll call for help," she said, reaching for her comm.
"No! No time! He needs help now!"
He grabbed her hand and pulled her toward the alley. She tugged back, uncertain she could even help him. "We have security in the building." Roach really put on the act now, gasping for breath as he cried,
"Daddy, he needs help now! Please help him!"
All right, I'll go look. Just relax." She hurried to the alley, still reaching into her pocket for a communicator. She wasn't qualified to help anyone in need, but the boy was hysterical, so... Rounding the corner, she only saw a wig that looked just like her hair sitting on a dumpster. She turned to see the boy with a blaster out pointed at her. He fired. Blue light of a stun blast hit her and knocked her unconscious.
"She'll be all right, Reggie. I just stunned her. Don't worry, I have a plan,"
Roach said, and he began to undress her.
"Don't worry, I have a plan,"
Roach said, and he began putting the woman's clothes onto himself. Reggie uncomfortably kept watch while Roach finished dressing up as the woman, then put on the wig.
"How do I look?"
he asked.
"I know I don't look like her yet. Hold on."
Roach plucked some hair from her head. Reggie was very agitated now, and Roach told it to relax as he pulled out his synth skin. He plugged the hair into a slot to get the DNA sample. Then he pointed the lens toward himself. A 3D projection of the woman's face formed across his face, then remained there after he turned the device off. Roach looked at Reggie and said,
"Now how do I look? Everyone's a critic."
The two walked back toward the building and strolled inside. "Back so soon, Stolly?" came a voice. Roach almost didn't react, but Reggie bumped him to remind him.
"What? Yeah,
he said. The security guard leaned forward and looked him over. "There a problem with your voice?" Roach coughed a couple times and said,
Yes, a bad cold just came on. I just had to get my droid from the droid shop."
The man was staring at her critically. He could tell something was up. "Something has changed about you," he said. Roach shrugged and coughed uncomfortably. Then the guard said, "I know what it is. You're wearing a dress. I could have sworn you were wearing a skirt this morning."
"Got me,"
Roach said.
"It's how I look when I take off my heels. I was wearing platforms earlier."
"Oh well, you're the boss," the guard said, and leaned back.
"I sure am. And as the boss, I would like you to escort me to my office."
"Well, I can walk you to the elevator, Miss Skystrider," he said, "but you're gonna need to go to the 15th floor yourself."
"Fine, I'll just walk myself,"
he said, striding by. But just before he was past, he stopped and said,
"And by the way, I declare every day to be Casual Friday."
The guard looked at him confused, and Reggie pushed Roach along. The two of them exited the elevator on the 15th floor and began looking around. The offices were labeled with names on them, so they sought out the offices of Stolly Skystrider. As Roach had hoped, it was a corner office. He and Reggie slipped inside, closed the door, and made themselves comfortable. Roach's feet dangled in the air when he sat in the office chair. He turned on the computer and started hacking his way through it. With as much initial security clearance as he already had in the office, it was not difficult for him to slice through their protocols to gain access to the financial records of all the major houses. He had Reggie plug into the access port and start downloading everything he had opened up. He then went about shifting some money around. He saw that Petro and Van Drawn had recently acquired a lot of money, so he transferred 10,000 credits each from Casito, Petro, and Van Drawn to a local company in Garjan. He also transferred money from an Imperial account to House Araba. It took some time to do, as he had to break through Imperial firewalls on top of some others, but after some time he was able to pull all of it out and make a transfer that looked suspiciously like the Empire and Araba had a secret deal on the side. As he finished up, people were coming back from their lunch breaks, and some of them were looking oddly through the window at him. A few of them looked as though they were whispering among each other, glancing at the closed door every now and then. He asked Reggie if it was done, and Reggie confirmed it was, so Roach closed up what he was doing. He had hacked into their security system, and he saw through the security camera at the front. A woman was walking in through the front door in only her underwear, Stolly. the real one. The guard rose to his feet and hurried to her. They were talking, then hurrying to the elevator.
Time to go, Reggie,
Roach said. Then,
you might want to wear a hat.
He hopped off the chair and hurried to the door where he grabbed a coat. He threw it over Reggie, then jumped back on the chair. He saw in the security feed that the guard and Stolly were in the elevator now on their way up. He sliced through the security systems to the fire protocols and set them off. Sprinkler systems turned on and sirens blew. The elevator stopped where it was and opened its doors to whatever floor it was on. The guard jumped in front of Stolly to shield her from view of those on the floor that had opened up to them. Roach and Reggie hurried out of the room. The others in the cubicles were making their way to the stairs to get out. Roach and Reggie made their way to the freight elevator, which Roach had isolated, and they rode it down to the back. There they made their escape. But as they did, Reggie whistled that they had passed a couple security cameras. Roach called the others and said that he probably had an urgent need. Yalta responded, asking for his status.
I'm pretty good, Yali, but I think we might have been spotted. I'm moving kind of fast. How are you?
That's a problem. Who spotted you?
I got this,
Doubly said.
Tell me your coordinates, Termite. I'll come get you.
He was already at the long-term parking of the spaceport, and he found a land speeder he was able to hop into. There, he hot-wired the vehicle while he listened to Roach say where he was. By the time the kid finished, Doubly had the car running and was on his way. Roach had gotten to a corner, and he spotted police vehicles closing in from two directions. One was Imperial, the other was a local house vehicle. He may be able to run for it, but Reggie would not make it far. He called into his comm.
Guys?
Stay put, Termite. I'm almost there.
No sooner had the words emerged from Doubly's mouth than his vehicle flew out of nowhere and zipped up in front of Roach.
Pilot guy Doubly!
Roach shouted.
Get in, lest you want to sleep in prison for a while.
Roach was already tossing Reggie in the back, then hopped in the passenger side. The police vehicles turned on their sirens and took chase. Doubly pushed the limit on the land speeder. It was someone's sports vehicle, intended for fun drives or street racing, and Doubly used every ounce of its speed and handling. He took a sharp turn and fired a wild volley of shots at the pursuers. They were forced to scatter, and he took the opportunity to race ahead. Just as they began to organize, he took a sharp turn and slowed dramatically.
Get out!
He shouted, and Roach did as commanded, taking Reggie with him. Doubly got out as well, but set the vehicle to autopilot, and they ran into an alley before the two police speeders came around the corner, joined by more and more police speeders. They had gotten out just in time. Yalto arrived at the Kellerman offices to a sight he had not expected. They were packing up their most sensitive information and leaving. Yalto found an attaché and asked what was going on. She explained that there was an attempt to blow up their offices, and although it failed, they knew that it was not the last assassination attempt that would be made. The ambassadors had determined that there were enough troubles at home that they would be more useful there than here, so they were packing everything up and leaving in a hurry. Yalto asked to speak with the head diplomat, but he had already been whisked away, so he asked to speak with one of the other managing ambassadors. One of them provided a little time as he loaded onto a vehicle. Yalto tried desperately to convince him that this was their one opportunity to kick the Empire out so they could not back House Casito.
The vote might very well rely on you,
Yalto insisted. They'll have to do it without us, the ambassador said, explaining that their government was simply not willing to put their entire diplomatic team in danger. Yalto played his final hand, admitting the real reason they were there.
Our plan is to take out the Imperial Tower looming over the city, he said.
The ambassador looked out at the looming dark skyscraper surrounded by its impenetrable wall. Then he gave Yalto a piece of information that may be helpful. This city was not first settled by humans, he said. There was an ancient alien race that lived here first. The houses built over their ruins. But where they built over the ruins, they didn't do so directly over the structures. There was a shell over them. Some say you can stand between the outer metallic hulls and the inner stone walls.
How did we get to them?
Yalto asked as the car started up. The ambassador shrugged, then said, If only there were records as to how the aliens built their cities. And with that, his vehicle took off. Yalto was helpless but to simply watch them leave, driving out of sight toward the spaceport and away from the growing danger of the United Houses. We'll be right back. you enjoyed this video, please thumb us below and let your friends know. Also put in the comments anything you think the characters should have done differently. Click on the next video to continue watching the story, and you can find other stories written by the author in the description below. May the Force be with you, and happy gaming, everybody.